I'd like to open up tonight's Policy Committee meeting. It's Tuesday, November 1st, 2016. It's 5:40 in the North Boardroom, and we'll take the roll. Mrs. Hohensee's here. Mr. Kaufman's here.
Here.
Ms. Van Twyver.
Here.
Mr. Farrington is absent. Ms. Zeem is here. Other attendees are Mr. Fredrickson, Ms. Norris, and I think we're ready to start. I'd like to start with IKF, high school graduation. We reconsidered this at our last full board meeting. I'd ask Mr. Fredrickson to present why it was brought to us, so everybody can understand the logic of where we've been. Mr. Kaufman will present something brief on the little screen, and then we'll open to public comment with your comments on this same policy.
Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity to take a relook at this policy. The initial policy was changed to reflect the minimum requirements that were called out in 306, but those changes don't necessarily, they do not reflect the program we currently offer in Nashua and as reflected by the course of studies, the current course of studies and footsteps. We did make a good step forward toward meeting the requirements of Ed 306 and the new requirement by specifying a math and English experience of every year at the high school, and that is currently in the new revision of IKF. I hope that is one area that we will maintain, we will not look to change. This would also be reflected in the course of studies for 2017-2018, which is being worked on and has gone through the curriculum committee. It's pretty good in the sense that it identified a number of math requirements, such as CTE and other courses that went through a pretty thorough review by the both schools. I think everyone would agree that this change in the policy is fine. I'm happy that we are reviewing two other components of IKF for possible reconsideration, and you'll hear from both high schools on their thoughts on why that what that policy should require. The first is increasing world studies back to the original one credit requirement. You will hear from both head teachers at the high school as to why that is critical. This is a critical course to have that depth of study to make sure that students are both academically and socially prepared to go out in the world. The reduction of the course from 1 to 1.5 credits just really confuses the students. There is no desire by any of the schools to reduce that from the current 90-day structure that it's at. The Algebra 1 requirement was removed from IKF with the intent of meeting that requirement by other means, you know, either a combination of other courses or development of other courses. At this time, we do not have a way to meet that algebra requirement by other means. The current program would require students to take Algebra 1 to at least meet the minimum requirements of the three algebra courses. It's a prerequisite for a number of other courses, plus in order to get through, if you look through the course of studies, in order to get that minimum of three math requirements, you're gonna have to take Algebra 1 because it is a prerequisite for a number of other courses. There was another thing that was brought up, and I know it's not, I don't know if it's part of this discussion on IKF. I realize Ms. Hohensee had brought it up as there is a new state requirement for students to take an assessment test in government and physics. There is a requirement to take that test, but there is no requirement, I know as ridiculous as it sounds, to pass it. And you know, later on I'll share that, I'll share some more information on that. So that, I guess what I would like to do is, again, I wanna thank you for reconsidering, and you know, I think you're gonna hear from people from the audience that why it makes sense to go back to a world studies course of one credit. You're gonna see a number of things that they can't get through the curriculum and how important it is on what they do have to get through to do that over a semester. And then you're gonna hear where we are in terms of meeting the algebra requirement. You're gonna see that we, at this point, we have no other way to meet that requirement, so, okay?
Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Kaufman.
Thanks, Mr. Fredrickson. I have a couple of questions. How long would it take for the curriculum to be developed to replace the algebra? In other words, if we went with the existing policy that doesn't, we don't have in place the courses yet to implement the policy that we updated, is that right?
That's correct.
So how long would it take for us to get ready to do a combined hybrid or whatever that, whatever replacement for Algebra 1 we would need to have? How long would it take to develop that?
To be quite honest with you, I don't know. It'd have to be investigated to see how long. I would suspect it wouldn't be ready. It certainly wouldn't be ready by the next school year. It may go beyond that. So I would think that would be something we'd have to pull a team together to take a look at. And, you know, I've talked with a couple people, and they talked about doing integrated math. But we really have to take a look at it and see if it makes sense for our schools. And, you know, I'm not ready to make a statement that something like integrated math or something like that would make sense with what's currently going on at the school. So I don't have an answer to that. So that's why the way removing that Algebra 1 requirement now currently confuses kids, because they think that they could, you know, if it's not on there, even though it's called out in the competencies, you need to do the algebra. The only way you can meet that requirement is by taking the Algebra 1.
Would it be your recommendation, the administration, that we restore the Algebra 1 requirement?
I would say at this time, because I think it confuses kids.
And since I have you, the same thing with the history, your remarks, what I thought I heard was...
So I think both, I think when you're talking, as you're talking two different, with the world studies, I think you're gonna find when you hear from the social studies teachers that looking at meeting that in half the time is not gonna be possible for what they do in that class. And I think, you know, they'll be quite articulate in expressing that. When you're talking about the Algebra 1 requirements, there may be other pathways down the road to kind of develop that. So my recommendation with the World Studies is I would leave that as is and not look at, you know, I mean, unless if there's another way to meet what they're going to talk about, I would leave that as is, you know, with the full credit. And then if you're going to look at the Algebra 1, I would go ahead and investigate if there's other ways to meet that requirement. But right now, I just think it's very confusing for kids. So my recommendation is to restore the Algebra 1 requirement or statement on there somewhere in the policy, and then restore the World Studies back to 1 credit. Yes.
Thank you very much.
A little bit long-winded, but that's...
Well, that's okay. It's good to have the reasoning behind it. Thank you.
Mr. Kaufman, did you want to do a
presentation? So what I was hoping to do tonight was, I didn't expect that. So hopefully that takes some of the air out of the balloon that the recommendation of the administration is to restore the Algebra 1 requirement and to restore the full credit for the world history. And I think that'll find its way back to the board as a recommendation Should we just make a motion to that effect?
We still have public comment. They can abbreviate it if they want. But I thought you just wanted to give a rundown of what you were asking in terms of feedback moving forward from the teachers.
So bear with me for a second, and then lots of opportunity for your input. Input. Okay, we want your opinion. So what I did is I reached out to the members of this committee, and I reached out to several of the staff and the principals to ask their opinion as to what the requirements should be for high school graduation. When I found myself reviewing this policy, even after we passed it, for me it was confusing. And then, so it's my hope with feedback, input from those in attendance here tonight, and plus I'm sure we'll have a lot more discussion, would be to really identify, I don't have a pointer, I'm sorry, but the minimum requirements, we call a standard diploma, 14 credits, and those are pretty well outlined. And let me just make a quick change here, and I'll just do this. I know to change it, okay? And the same thing with the World Studies. Now, what I can use some help with in understanding, I love charts, okay? So since we have three different, well, we say we have three different tiers of graduation, but after looking at the policy, to me, it looked as though we had four. We had the 14 required credits, then we had a 20 credit diploma, which was awarded based on special circumstances, and then we had the 27 and the 32 credit options. So if we're going to go through the effort, and I think it's a responsible thing to do, of identifying specific courses for requirements, as is the case for the minimum requirement of three credits as being Algebra 1 based upon previous conversation, I'm curious and would like to know the recommendations that our attendees have as to how that might, what, if it's required in the baseline, it would require it everywhere else, right? It's a minimum, it's a prerequisite. So are there additional math classes for the core diploma, the advanced diploma, the diploma with distinction that we would like, that you would like us to include as minimum requirements for graduation? So that's a conversation. One of the reasons why we handed out the sheet was so that I hope by the time you leave here, you'll actually fill it out and leave us with your recommendations so we as a committee can process them.
If you'd like to come to the microphone. Yeah, if you'd like to speak, we could use you to give your name, address, and then please speak up.
My name is Kathy Eicher. I'm a business teacher at South, also a Nashville resident, 6 Tinker Road. Just for clarification, there is no such thing, as far as my understanding, of the 14 credit option. The state minimum standard requires 6 elective classes to bring it up to 20. So that left column doesn't exist.
Okay. And that should be considered, is it named a standard diploma, though?
It's named, no, that would be...
That's the core diploma?
Yes.
With the additional credits?
Yes.
Thank you.
The New Hampshire, and Lori, correct me if I'm wrong, but the core diploma is the state minimum, with the exception of the half-credit world studies.
So the core diploma is the 14 credits. The standard diploma is the 14 plus the 6?
There is no 14 diploma.
Minimum requirements, which is the 14 identified credits plus the elective.
Plus the electives.
That's what the state requires, so you can't have a 14. Right. A student does not receive a diploma with 14 credits.
20 is the minimum for the core diploma.
And I'm not sure if you have the document that I had submitted to you.
Yes.
But all of this that you're asking us to do is already done in that document that I gave you.
Okay. Oh, good. Oh. So
That's all I need.
Maybe it would be helpful if I bring up your document then.
That's fine with me.
Okay. Ms. Eicher was eloquent and verbose to explain things to me in an email. So let me bring that up.
Ms. Wansey?
Yes, Mrs. Van Twyver.
Could I request that a copy of that be sent to members of the committee, please?
Certainly.
You did. Oh, Ms. Eicher's?
Yes.
Yes, absolutely. Do you want to help me out here and annotate what you're doing?
Oh, thank you.
Okay.
Oh, perfect.
So this is the revised chart.
It's a
proposal.
The way it is right now.
Right.
So
you took.
Everything in cayenne color is the way it is now.
Okay. Thank you.
Policy as it stands in the footsteps right now.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
So. Okay. So. So if we talk about math for a second. And we look, I'm referring to the blue section on the chart that's displayed. So we have Algebra 1 as a requirement across the board, and in the, sorry, core program, sorry, with distinction, there's a fourth credit, but there's no specificity in terms of what it should be. So is there a recommendation for a specific course, or is it sufficient enough to indicate an additional credit?
Well, I think this is better. It's more, it, this proposal gives more clarity to what is needed than what we had before.
Yes.
I think your reading of it indicates that there was some confusion, whether it's just you or it's broader. So in that sense, it'd be interesting to think in something that had a grid.
And maybe that's not a question. I don't want to put everybody on the spot tonight, but it's certainly information we want to receive so we can aggregate it and maybe come back and of the people who responded, this is what the feedback was. I don't think we're going to, I don't plan on making a decision okay. on these additional requirements at this time. I think we can probably bring forward a recommendation regarding the algebra and the world history, but this other part of the conversation is a conversation that's in process. So that's my intent for what it's worth.
You need to come to the mic, please. Are you done after this? We'll do public comment.
Thank you. Hi, Kelly Gabriel, head of the math department at South. And I was going to speak to the Algebra 1 reinstatement, but Mr. Fredrickson did a great job, and I'm appreciative that this is then going back to being a graduation requirement. I just wonder, with respect to what we already have in our program of studies, what is the intention of adapting it or changing it?
For me, it's clarification.
Okay. So what already exists is unclear, is what you're saying.
When I went through my exercise and I tried to figure out, because the first time I saw it was when the policy came through the committee the last time. And then the feedback, and then, you know, admittedly, we passed something that was done hastily, and we're fortunately able to correct that. And so my intent is, if algebra should be a baseline requirement across the board, fine. If there should be another math, if it's geometry, then let's say it.
Yeah.
You know, that's, because I think that helps, the students will understand.
Yeah, I would love to see 4 credits of math, but I didn't know that this was part of what we were discussing. I'd love to see Algebra 1 and geometry be requirements for all graduates. That's just me speaking.
For each diploma?
For each diploma, yeah. I think that in general happens. There are certain exceptions in different cases. I polled the schools at my recent math meet. There were 25 schools, and asked about the graduation requirements in each of their schools, and they all require Algebra 1, and some that require 2 years of a math, 3 credits. Those that had an integrated program required integrated 1 and integrated 2, and that made up for the Algebra 1 and the geometry graduation requirement. Many schools had 4 credits. So I would love to see that, but I didn't know that was up for discussion.
Well, we might as well have the discussion. That's kind of how I looked at it. So NC didn't seem to disagree. So
I think this is an opening of a broader discussion. That part doesn't have to be decided tonight. But when Mr. Kaufman was going through it, this was confusion that he wanted clarified. So when you were all coming, he thought he would hand this out and just get sort of that extra feedback, because it's wonderful getting feedback. So.
And I would say this likely has to go to the curriculum committee anyway at some point. So it's discussion.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. We have five other people that have signed up for public comment. If they'd like to, one by one, come down. Mike McQuicklin?
Yes.
Okay.
Mike McQuicklin, Nashua South, head teacher for social studies. I have a prepared statement that the North and South social studies teachers put together that I'd like to read. We are requesting that world studies remain a one-credit course. You've heard the concerns of our teachers through a series of emails during the past few weeks. Thank you for hearing those concerns and agreeing to reconsider the policy. Both high schools have collaborated to issue the following statement on behalf of our social studies teachers. World studies is an exceptionally important course in the social studies department. It's the foundation of social studies education in Nashua and also serves as a bridge to Western civilization courses that are taught at the post-secondary level. Included in the curriculum is the origin of modern political thought, the groundwork behind the United States democracy, geography, and the roots of conflict that exist in the contemporary world. World studies also covers the geography requirement set forth by the state of New Hampshire. This is a concept that students need time to show for proficiency, as political and physical geography is a landscape that's constantly changing. With a small emphasis on geography, students will lack the necessary skills and information needed to draw inferences and formulate conclusions. Educators need time to spiral their lessons, and the quarter simply does not allot enough time to assure the students are completely grasping the material. Time must be allotted so that the students can fully grasp concepts as they relate to the material. For instance, cause and effect is an essential skill that students need to grasp. This skill is cemented in world studies and helps students become critical thinkers, directly improve their performance in classes across the curriculum. This occurs through analysis and evaluation, comprehension, drawing conclusions, making references, reading, writing, and speaking. Our assessments evaluate students on these skills and provide them feedback on improvements. This feedback is critical to get students to a higher depth of knowledge as they progress through high school. Throughout the course of a semester, teachers can assess the students several times to build their skills and their content knowledge. If this class were to be cut to half a credit, we have to eliminate many assessments, and students would only be exposed to a limited amount of content and would be only working on skills necessary and would not be working on the skills necessary to become lifelong learners of history and the social studies. Aside from the amount of content that we're required to cover, a course that runs roughly 45 days is not nearly long enough to create informed citizens. It's our obligation as social studies educators to prepare students for the world, and the students need to learn how to evaluate multiple ideologies and apply the concepts introduced in class to the real world. A quarter class would only allow for enough time to scratch the surface and introduce these topics rather than formulate and prove hypotheses. Essentially, world studies begins with the Age of Enlightenment until the conclusion of World War II. The breadth that this course covers allows for the depth of instruction in later social studies courses. World studies sets the stage for civics, economics, and United States history, along with several elective courses students take during their 4 years at Nashua North and South. The ideas of Smith and Montesquieu are introduced to world studies, and their thoughts and ideas are expanded upon in economics and civics. If world studies omits such content, a domino effect would occur that adversely affects economics and civics. World studies simply can't be taught as a quarter class, as 45 days is not long enough to cover almost 300 years of historical content. Time must be spent to ensure that students are achieving proficiency on the third and fourth levels on the depth of knowledge scale. With such a short amount of time and a colossal amount of material to cover, students will only be able to simply regurgitate arbitrary facts rather than synthesize, analyze, and critique important events in world history. Without a full semester of world history, students will have no basis of understanding the origins of the United States government, or any government for that matter. As teachers, we spend a tremendous amount of time analyzing the ideas of John Locke, Hobbes, Voltaire, Rousseau, and connect them to the philosophy that the Founding Fathers fostered when creating the United States Constitution. Time is also necessary to ensure that students understand the ideological differences between government systems and why a democracy run by the people is considered to be the best form of government available. One of the most important units in world studies covers the rise of totalitarian dictatorships in the 20th century. This is an extremely important concept because a vulnerable society can easily be taken advantage of. As educators, it's our responsibility to build an informed society that will not fall victim to this type of situation. If handcuffed to 45 days, teachers will be forced to omit such important lessons from our curriculum, directly affecting student understanding of society. We need to foster and create passionate, intelligent students, not just churn out robots with no ability to question authority. World studies allows students to think critically and analyze the past, to understand modern-day conflict, and to become active 21st century citizens. Without it, we will be doing the community a disservice, as our students will simply be devoid of these critical skills that are needed to function in our society. A quarter simply only allows teachers to scratch the surface, rather than dive into the complex material that has shaped the current backdrop of the world today. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Do you have a copy you could share with us?
I do. I have copies for you guys.
I would love that for our, the secretary keeps the minutes.
Absolutely.
Mrs. Zeem?
I would just like to ask that when you come up, and I have a particular concern. I am not an educator, nor would I ever challenge your ability over mine. Having said that, though, one of my concerns is that we, in the last, Mrs. Ivers, I believe, mentioned that she would like geometry and another class as well in an ideal world. My concern is that when you have students who can't read, I mean, when you have foundation students who don't have the foundation for algebra, then as I did not have, I tell you that honestly, not something I should admit in public probably, but I find that honesty is the best policy. So having said that, I would just like to hear, and maybe we're headed, if indeed we're headed to that point in time where we will separate the college bound as opposed to the 43% who are graduating not reading on grade level, then that satisfies me. But if that's my concern, I would just like to hear, I'm sure you have thoughts on that that I haven't considered. And if you do, I would like to hear them. Thank you so much.
I don't know if that, was that a question directed towards me?
No, don't
that
take
that. That was to everybody. and I don't, the quarter class as opposed to the, I have no problem with that at all. It sounds very reasonable what you're, I mean, just the magnitude of what you're trying to teach them is obviously not a quarter class. So I don't have a problem with that. My problem is this thing of do we at some point in time want to try to focus with these kids who are obviously not going to go to college? I mean, how can you teach somebody algebra if they can't read? That's my question, I guess. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate the reconsidering this motion. Thank you.
Thank you. And I'd love the copy of the...
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you. Our next speaker, Mr. Kaufman, do you have something?
I was just going to say something. Let's do it.
Yeah. Andy O'Keefe?
Otaka.
Oh, it's a T.
Good evening. Andy Otaka, head social studies teacher at North and Nashua resident, 39 Lutheran Drive. And I'm here to speak a little bit about something Mr. Fredrickson brought up earlier, addressing questions on the topic of how we're currently approaching citizenship competencies in our civics classes. The basic requirements for instruction on civics, government, and citizenship are outlined in Revised Statutes of New Hampshire, Chapter 189, Section 11. The law states that this instruction must begin before eighth grade and must continue in high school as an identifiable component in a year's course in the history and government of both the United States and New Hampshire. In Nashua, we are clearly in compliance with these requirements as our civics courses, which run for 9 weeks, they're a quarter course, is a graduation requirement typically taken in 10th grade. It complements our U.S. history course, which is also a graduation requirement and is typically taken in 11th grade. So we cover these subjects not once but twice. In the past year, an additional requirement has been attached to the original law. The center of the new requirement is the creation of a competency assessment on U.S. government and civics that includes, and I quote, the nature, purpose, structure, function, and history of the United States government, the rights and responsibilities of citizens, and noteworthy government and civics, civic leaders, end quote. The law states that this competency assessment must be locally developed, but allows that the U.S. Citizenship and Immigration Services test for naturalizing citizens may be used in lieu of a locally developed assessment. I can state with full confidence that we are meeting this new requirement at both North and South as our civics courses are being taught and assessed currently. The required content about government, citizenship rights and responsibilities, and political leadership is reflected in both our curriculum documents and our practice. It is taught and assessed by every teacher teaching civics at our high schools.
Thank you. Could you also leave me a hard copy of that? That's what I meant when I, so
sure
I can
thing.
Put in with the minutes.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I have one question. Would you have any objection if we added something to the policy to require that U.S. Citizenship and Immigration Service test to be given to our students? Or
just,
do we have something similar to that?
We have similar things. I know that, as I said, every teacher that we have teaches citizenship, requirements and responsibilities, and they all assess on that. Now, you know, those assessments take different forms. So I guess that's my answer. Do I have any personal objection to it? No, I don't.
Okay.
But I know that we are already doing this, I guess is what I'm saying.
Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Our next speaker, Paul Menard.
Good evening. Paul Menard. Social studies teacher here at North, 7C Taggart Drive. I had intended on echoing the words and thoughts of my colleagues, Mr. McQuilkin and Mr. Otaka, but I thought that I might alter them a moment to address Ms. Zeem's observation, her concern. As I understand it, there is a recognition that not all of our students may be aspiring to the same level. So I'm gonna differ a little bit here from what I started, but I did start with George Santayana, who is often misquoted as saying, those who do not remember the past are condemned to repeat it. However, the actual language used by Santayana is, those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it. This is an important distinction because Santayana is referring to those who are literally incapable of learning from their actions or the actions of those around them. Because they are incapable of creating memory, there's nothing to prevent them from becoming creatures of habit. It is this automatic reproduction of behavior that Santayana is warning us of. This is why mistakes are repeated. As we have no memory of them, we cannot avoid making them again. Among those most vulnerable to this fate are children and the uneducated. The curriculum for world history, the curriculum for civics, the curriculum that exists through our U.S. history and economics, behavioral science, which I teach, is imbued at its core with this idea of exposing students to the necessary ideas, concepts, and past events that they will need to go forward, whether it is to college, whether it is to trade school, whether it is to the corner market or the corner office. We do our students an injustice if we do not, through differentiated instruction, through various assessments, through, again, just through straight up exposure to the breadth of cultural history. If we don't prepare them with those things, they cannot leave here and be productive members of society, whatever that looks like. And so I would encourage you all to preserve this world history at its one semester full credit course, as that is, as we've heard, the only way we're going to enable our students to get everything. Civics, cannot teach the revolutions. U.S. history cannot teach the Age of Enlightenment and do its own curriculum. So we need these large, We need these large time-committed courses so that we can cover absolutely everything. Because as Ms. Zim observed, not everybody who comes in has the same starting point. We need to make sure that when we get our students, we at least communicate with them everything that we can in the time we have. And we cannot blame what happened after, and we cannot trust, or we cannot blame what happened before, and we cannot trust in what happens after. We need to inform them as we have them now, and we need time to do that. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Can I take your class?
You certainly may.
That sounded wonderful.
Our next speaker will be Kelly Gabriel.
Hi, Kelly Gabriel, head of the math department at South. I guess, Mrs. Zim, I'd like to speak to your issue or your concern, and we have those same concerns as students come into the high school below reading level. At this juncture, we have initiated a pilot for our most struggling learners in mathematics. So we have a team of teachers that are teaching two sections of what we call math skills review and pre-algebra for a full year. So these are our most struggling learners. They're learning with manipulatives. They're learning math in a way that, they can understand concepts and through critical thinking can develop algebraic thinking skills. We need professional development. I know as you're looking at budget constraints coming up, and sure, this is as good a time as any to talk about the needs for those students and the needs for the teachers to help with those students. As we have had algebra as a graduation requirement, I can speak to the special ed department, who in the past has just taught general math courses. So currently they're teaching general algebra and general geometry and having success with those students. So we're helping students with critical thinking, and I think that's one of those mathematical practices of persevering and thinking critically, critiquing the reasoning of others. All of these are important concepts for our students, struggling or excelling. I did want to speak to the algebra 1 requirement. I did want to speak to this is nerve-wracking. Okay, thank you. I know you are. I thought maybe if we did have an alternative option for Algebra 1, I wonder if considerations were to be made about how that would be offered. And I know I've heard that it could be offered through CTE, and I wonder if, we are highly qualified teachers in math, and would we require non-math teachers to be certified in math? I wonder if we thought about how this would affect our SAT scores if we, did not have the Algebra 1 requirement. I wonder how this would impact college admissions. And I wonder, as we embark on our NEASC evaluation, how that would look to our evaluators. So I speak to reinstating the Algebra 1 requirement, but I also speak to our passion for teaching all students. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our last speaker is Hannah Lambert.
Hi. Hi, I'm Hannah Lambert, a senior student at Nashua South, and I would just like to give a student perspective on the concerns the social studies department of both schools have raised about making the world studies a half credit. So having taken world studies freshman year myself, I'm surprised at the suggestion of making it a quarter class. I took the subject as a full year AP course, and the pacing of a class teaching 300 years of history was the fastest that I had ever had, even with 180 days. Having the extra time an AP course entailed, it allowed me to not only learn more detailed content, but also time to practice analytical skills that would assist me all throughout my high school career, and not only in history classes. With this experience behind me, I can safely say that regular semester world studies is a course gallantly straining to fit 300 years of history in only 90 days. To cut that allowance to a mere 45 days would be a disservice to not only students, but teachers as well. 45 days is not enough time for a student to properly learn and execute such skills as recognizing patterns and analyzing cause and effect, skills that will not only service them for the rest of their high school career, but far beyond. Furthermore, 45 days is simply not enough time for students to learn, nor teachers to teach, history that is their right to know and content that is owed to them to help them understand where they stand in the world today. I believe the intricacy and depth of the World Studies class I had the privilege of taking not only made me a lifelong lover of history, but gave me the experience needed to master analytical skills that gave me a leg up in all of my other courses. And I believe it wouldn't be right to take away other students' chances of having the same experience.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else that wanted to speak that didn't get a chance to sign in?
Come on down.
Hello, my name is Mabel Brown, and I'm a teacher, World Studies teacher here at North. So, you know, when the information came out that they were going to reduce World Studies, a lot of teachers came to visit me to see how I was doing, because this has been my baby for so long. So I was very relieved to hear it sounds like it's, it seems like you guys see that how important the half credit is. And I would argue our students should be getting two classes, one in world history, but also there is a contemporary global studies class that looks at what is going on today. And just to tell you a little bit about that course, when I started the course, we were 1 week into it. It was the spring semester. And 1 week into it, the Arab Spring happened. And I said, hey guys, you know all your history books? Throw them out, because guess what just happened? History's being made right now. And I was able to put on the news, and kids are seeing Facebook posts and people in Egypt having a revolution and what this looks like in real time and what's going on today. And so for them to be able to see it and see Facebook pages and then going on it and saying, this is really happening. This is going to be in my kid's history book. This is big, and it's huge. Looking at world history, when I'm looking at the French Revolution and the horrendous human rights to the what was going on in the French Revolution, and comparing that today to ISIS and seeing how similar the two, and analyzing how did they get there? How did something like this happen? And be able to have a solid foundation on where it happened. These are important things our students need to know going forward, especially as they look at choosing senators, presidents, things like that. Can you analyze and look at what's happening? And so in that way, and also looking at New Hampshire's very important role in world history, it's great to make those connections. When it comes to our populations who are foundation level, so you know, I teach actually foundation level all the way up to AP World History, so I've seen all students. And I gotta tell you, there's a brilliance we have with our foundation level that's not tapped enough. We have students who have immigrated into this area from all over the world, and we're seeing students here, not only from Latin America, which had often been the case, but we have these amazing migrant students coming in, and I've got to tell you, they understand everything they're learning, and they know the value better than any other students I have ever seen regarding education. It's amazing. And here I am teaching imperialism, and here, it, you know, the student might be from Congo speaking French. Well, if he's in Africa, why is he speaking French? We're covering that in the world studies curriculum. So when we're looking at this, we're analyzing, we're evaluating the competency developed. I love the competencies that we have in this course. I consider it a privilege that I got to work on that. But I also work with ELL students, IEP students, and there is a brilliance there. And being able to associate with what's going on in the world helps them so much. And it does bring out, whether it's by speaking, we're developing writing skills or whatnot, there's so much we're doing in the class. So I would argue again, this shouldn't be just one credit. I think we need two credits. They're getting U.S. history all the way up through school. U.S. history is important, but world studies and getting to what's going on today is really important. And Alexandra Norris, well, you guys like her, I hope. If you like her, I'm very proud that she was one of my AP students. If not, I'm going to blame Mrs. Rich. So she had us both. But I love the course. I love what's in the course. And hopefully you can see a little bit of my passion on why this is so important to keep, at least as one credit, half credit. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else?
Good evening. My name is Catherine Poulin, 52 Laurel Court, Nashua, New Hampshire. I come before you tonight not as an 18-year veteran of the Social Studies Department, but as a citizen and a taxpayer. And we all know the budget's coming up and we have some concerns. But at the same token, I like to know I'm getting value for my dollar. And I don't mind investing if there's value at the other end. And as such, I anticipate graduates will have certain knowledge and experience upon graduating. And I find it egregious when basics are ignored. I would anticipate that students would know the fundamentals of the reasons why the United States was founded. This is explained in the Enlightenment period, perhaps more than any place else, and is a hallmark of the World Studies class. I would anticipate that students would know how our revolution and the Enlightenment were used by other countries, and how those countries were founded in the mid-1800s. Again, a World Studies unit. I would further anticipate students would know the roots of World War I and the folly that followed, which lay the groundwork for World War II. This is, again, an essential component of a World Studies classroom. I would also anticipate that a student, no matter on what level, would know a basic geography, which is also covered under World Studies. That is the essentials of what I would expect that any student, from all levels, below foundation all the way up through AP, and I've taught all levels, would actually comprehend and understand when they leave with a graduate, with a diploma from Nashua High School. The expectations of the average The expectations of the average taxpayer might arguably warrant World Studies to be a full year, two-credit course. We're also taxpayers. To relegate it to a half a credit is unfathomable. The least you can do is to vote to bring it back to a full semester class where students can learn the fundamentals of modern republicanism, 20th century, and geography. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Is there anyone else? Okay, is there any discussion on where we'd like to go with IKF from the committee? Mr. Fredrickson?
I had included in your packet a copy of IKF. It was very similar to what was there before, except it calls out the competency requirements and the math requirements and English requirements. That's the current format we're in. I don't know if that's what you were looking for.
Thank you. So you're suggesting that the red marks are the motions that perhaps we should make to readjust it back to include Algebra 1, a full credit for World Studies, but at the same time lead the list of integrated math possibilities going
absolutely.
Forward.
And then if in the future, I shouldn't say if in the future, when we do develop that alternative, whether it's through integrated math or something with the algebra, then we can come back to the table. But I think that's a bigger discussion.
Okay, great. And those would come back to curriculum probably?
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you very much. Any other discussion or a motion? Ms. Van Twyver.
Thank you. I just want to be clear that there's only two changes to IKF, and that is including Algebra 1 under the mathematics, and World Studies goes to one credit, right?
Correct.
Then I move that we recommend to the full board the changes to IKF as amended.
Okay, do we have a second? Mr. Kaufman seconds. Sorry, this is my first round as a secretary and a chair. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, nay. So we have that. That's 3-0. There was also in your packet a suggestion about amending IKF to include language as part of government and citizen instruction. Students shall be required to earn a passing grade on the U.S. Citizenship and Immigration Service test. That was recommended by this statute that passed March 16th, 2016. Is there any discussion on that, Mr. Fredrickson?
Yeah, the actual statute does not. It does require a test, which Mr. Otaka spoke to. That we were meeting that requirement. The only question may become: do we want to have a single assessment or not? But it does not require a passing on the test, which I know seems pretty odd, but that's the way the law is written. And I actually had some I got some legal input onto that when I went to a law conference. They talked about that specifically. And what they said was that the requirement is that you take an assessment test in that area, and the citizenship test would cover those requirements, but there is no requirement to pass it. There is the opportunity where we could issue certificates to acknowledge those kids that have passed it.
Okay, thank you. Could we just, I wasn't thinking of it as a final exam, but just add it as a competency, then it wouldn't be a life or death, but then they'd have to make it up, you're saying. So do you recommend this language at all, or do you recommend amending it in any way to include this citizenship test?
I mean, we can put it in the policy. I'm not sure if it needs to be developed in the policy. They didn't recommend, the lawyer didn't recommend that we develop a policy for it. I mean, you could certainly put it as part of the graduation requirements, or it may be something that we want to go through the curriculum committee for and ask, what's acceptable to be met, to meet this requirement. When I found out about it, which wasn't too long ago, I did interact even before this, it was going to come up in this committee. I did talk with both head teachers to assure, make sure that we were doing an assessment in there, and we are. But the concern I would have is that we would make that a requirement of graduation to pass the test when that is not a requirement in the state law.
So you're saying it's too, okay, the hurdle. Shall be asked to take the test? Is that something that they would be comfortable with, or is that still too high a hurdle?
I'm not sure what you're asking.
Instead of required to earn a passing grade on the test, can we suggest that they shall be required to take the test and then take the exam?
You could put that in the graduation requirements if you wanted. I mean, I'm not sure. So you wanted to put a statement in that as part of graduation, all students will take the assessment, and I'm not. You know what? I would ask for a little bit more feedback from maybe one of the head teachers at the high school, Mr. McQuilton.
Okay.
I don't know if.
Yep. Certainly. Ms. Van Twyver, if you want to just come up and be after Mrs. Van Twyver.
I'd like to know, you can answer too, what purpose the certificate serves. Just that hey, you're a good student and you know?
It's like an award. It's sort of like a star. You know, it's a prize. It's an encouragement. I don't think it's anything bigger than that. And I think that's what they put in law. This was a well thought out bill that went back and forth in the legislature. It was introduced by Senator Birdsell from Windham.
Sorry.
Mike McQuilkin, head teacher at Nashua South. So I'm pretty confident that at both schools, we meet these requirements through the many assessments that we do in our civics classes over the 45 days. We have a number of our UBD documents. We have a number of assessments that are common. Many teachers do give a version of the citizenship test to start the course, and then at the end of the course, they give it to them again to sort of see what their progress is. But the important elements within that test are part of the civics curriculum, as Mr. Otaka alluded to earlier. So, I'm pretty confident that that's covered. My fear is, to go back to what Mr. Fredrickson had suggested, if we make it a requirement that the students have to pass the test, this could be challenging for many of our students, particularly the ones, Ms. Zim, you had mentioned before, some of our lower level students who have trouble speaking English, who may not be citizens themselves, and so we're gonna ask them to pass this test and to graduate in a 45-day course, but yet when they're out, they're still not U.S. citizens. So, I think that might be a little stringent to mm-hmm. go that route. I firmly believe that we're covered in how we, how we implement the course as is. I think that we cover the material, the rights and responsibilities of citizens. I think that we cover, all kinds of items on the citizenship test.
Okay. Would it be a burden to give them the opportunity to take the test as under the requirement, just sort of like that we're covering that base, or?
Many of our teachers, we speak, Mr. Fredrickson.
I was just going to add, the requirement of law is that they do take some assessment. Are you talking about, when you're talking about take the test, are you talking about taking the citizens test?
I'm just looking, at the statute that there was a paragraph added, and I'm trying to put something in the requirements for graduation that we're going to align to this new requirement in some way that's not overly burdensome to the students, but, allows our students to shine if they've got the capacity.
So I do have a brief by Attorney Zalen. I don't know if that would help. That was at the, that might add some clarification to it, as to what's required. I don't know.
Maybe we'll share that with the committee and postpone any decision on this part?
That's what I would do. I think it requires a little more discussion and it may be something that we want to discuss with the curriculum committee as to exactly how we're gonna meet that, rather than through policy.
Because I just think it's a great opportunity to encourage the students to push and to get that certificate. It's a good bragging point on their applications to move on further. Mrs. Van Twyver?
I was a little confused maybe. Were you suggesting that they take the United States Citizenship and Immigration Services test?
That's, if you look below, that's what was put in the statute.
I know that's what's in the law, but what happens if they refuse to take it? I mean, I don't know why they would. Everyone loves to be.
So that's why we're thinking of lowering it to give them the opportunity to take this and upon completion of the course, somehow to put that in there.
Well,
I see we have somebody else that might want to comment.
Hi, Pat Johnson. I'm a social studies teacher at National High School North. I've taught civics for the past 11 years in the district. The citizenship test, it's 100 questions. But of those 100 questions, a person taking the citizenship test only has to be asked 10 of them, and then to pass the test, they need to answer 6 correctly. So in terms of like what kind of assessment you want to create, like it would be hard to make a common assessment out of those 100 questions, I guess. So I think before you make any decision, I would say further information is needed as to what you would want that assessment to look like.
That's very helpful, yes. Thank you. Okay, so we'll postpone decision on this and move to, Mr. Kaufman.
if I follow the example of one of our other speakers and put on my taxpayer hat, I would like to know that the kids we graduate can pass the citizenship test. And we can obviously take provision for someone who is not a citizen or is a new immigrant. But from what you said about our new immigrant students, I was very enthusiastic because I thought that their enthusiasm about American liberty might in fact become contagious to some of our own students who don't get it yet. And I imagine that those kids, our newcomers, are going to help raise the bar of enthusiasm and of interest in politics and history and civics. And I would even place a bet right now, I wouldn't be surprised if some of our new immigrant folks will pass that citizenship test. And sadly, that some of our own native-born will not. And I think we should have a requirement for the citizenship test.
Thank you. Ms. Vedweiver?
Six questions out of 10 passing. I think that our students are probably taking our own assessment test and do better than that. I can't imagine not doing more than six questions. That surprises me. But
70% and higher is our current passing grade.
Right.
Mr. Kaufman?
The six questions out of the 100 or whatever it turns out to be is only part of what's required for the citizenship test. There's also other requirements of interviewing, and they have to pass an interview, they have to show proficiency of language. So it's not just the civics piece, that the 10 questions or what they might be, doesn't constitute passing the citizenship test for citizenship. It just says it's the White House or it's 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue or there are three houses of Congress. Yeah, I'm a little familiar with it. So I think we can ask our students that. I don't think it's a stretch.
What I'm saying, Mr. Coffin, is that I think that our teachers are teaching more or test them more than just six questions on the subject. That's what I was saying.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, I think they get a much better understanding than just six questions proves.
Okay,
thank you. Ms. Zim?
It sounds to me like we're better off just to leave it like it was. It seems to me that you have justified by saying that they're getting it, that we're meeting all of those requirements. That says it all to me. So as far as I'm concerned, it's not necessary to put there at all, but I don't vote in this committee, so that was just a little hot air. Thank you.
Well, I think the statute was saying that they're encouraging students to have this opportunity, and it says right in the statute to give a certificate issued by the school. So I think it's trying to motivate and encourage students to become, you know, a little bit more knowledgeable on these issues. So
I don't challenge what you're saying. What I think I hear is that they're doing that anyway. They're doing above and beyond that. And if we impose some requirement, then are we going to get into a sticky wick that's not worth it for one out of 1,000 kids? That's what I'm taking you to be saying. But that doesn't mean I'm right. Thank you,
Mr. Fredrickson.
The one area that I had talked to Mr. McQuilkin about, and we had talked about, was the issuing of certificates for those kids, and he indicated that shouldn't be a problem. The kids that do pass for the state law, whatever the assessment is, whether it's the citizenship or not. So we've already talked about that.
Oh, great. Okay? That's good. It's encouraging to hear. The next policy we have is BEDB, Agenda Preparation and Dissemination. I think this is we're bringing this back. This had been discussed. Feel free to leave if you don't need to stay. Thank you very much for coming. It was nice to have so many people that are interested. I'm sorry for any confusion and reconsideration. Oh, perfect. Just leave it with Howard, though.
Well, he's going to email it.
Oh, you're going to email it? Okay, great. Thank you very much. So this we've looked at before, and I think this was brought back in perfect red line copy. So, Mr. Kaufman, did you want to present this? Was this yours, Once Upon a Time?
Yes, thank you.
I think what's in bold was added. The name of the board member making the agenda request shall be included on the agenda with the request, and In the event that the president is not available, approval shall be by the board clerk or the board president's designee. I think those were just added for clarity. And then down below, in the draft minute meetings, if they're unavailable, inclusion of the recommended motions for that committee report shall be deferred and follow to the following board meeting. All three changes were clarity driven.
Yes, thank you. I think you covered it.
Okay.
So
do we, oh, Mrs. Van Twyver.
I have a question on the third paragraph.
Certainly.
Sorry, Jimmy. The third paragraph, all board meetings shall be convened by the board president or his or her board member designee. The board policy says that the in the absence of the board president, the clerk will preside.
Yes.
And I question all board meetings, including committees, because
I guess these are the full board meetings is
then,
my understanding.
And I think that would be better clarified if you say all Board of Education meetings.
So all Board of Education meetings shall be convened by the board president or the board clerk.
Or in their absence.
Well, it's already contained in the board policies under, I don't remember exactly which one it was.
So you think we're being redundant here?
Yes.
And that can be taken out?
Yes, I do.
Okay, so they'll just strike it.
And I had a question about committee recommendations shall be taken directly from the motions found in the draft minutes of the meeting. And I can't, if the draft meeting minutes are unavailable, inclusion of the recommended motions for that committee report shall be deferred to the following board meeting.
I think that was to allow for something like this, where we barely had the minutes of the policy meeting out there, and yet the motion went forward to the full board, so they couldn't track what went on. So I guess it's sort of like slowing it down. Again, going back to Superintendent Brown's idea that there needs to be a certain pause between the introduction and the final passage of something. So having full transparency before we move to that last step is critical.
Well, I would like to emphasize the fact that doesn't preclude taking a handwritten meeting minutes.
Oh, so you're saying the draft minute meetings, the official draft minute meetings should...
The minutes taken at this meeting should be handwritten.
They are handwritten.
That's okay. That's so. What I'm... I don't want that to be...
Oh, no, that
interpreted
that won't disappear.
That you don't have to take handwritten minutes.
No, I don't think that was the intent at all. Any other discussion? Do we have a motion?
Motion to approve BEDB as amended.
As amended, you mean striking that
striking
third,
all
that third
board
paragraph
meetings shall be,
in
yes.
red. Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. All those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed, nay. Passes 3-0. To the next policy, which is BAAA, School Board Policies and Administrative Procedures. Sandra wanted to be around for this one, but she's stepped out. Do you want to skip over this one, or should we just go straight through it?
You want me to see if I can find her?
Well, no. We could postpone it to the end, or we can go straight through it. We've got to keep moving.
Well, I know she's here for the next one also, so I would say that we keep going.
Oh, okay, that was the one, GCO. So this one we can do without, in her absence.
Okay.
So Mr. Kaufman?
Thank you. The intent here is to clarify of the, well, largely that there are procedures, we've tried to define them, and that each procedure has a section header, much like what we do on the policy committee, and what is generally a standard practice for procedures and policies. It also requires that there be keep track of the revision history. On the paragraph below the one that starts administrative procedures, including formal student handbooks and employee handbooks are not board policy and may be altered by the administration without board action. Administrative procedure, however, the word may, I would like to change that to shall not conflict with board policy.
Okay.
I'm sorry, I missed this shall.
It's the black paragraph between the red, starting with administrative procedures. At the last sentence, he wants to have it shall not conflict instead of may not conflict with board policy. It's a one-word change.
And if we continue further down, the next to last paragraph is added the sentence as the last sentence. I'm sorry, we changed the language up front too. The school district administration shall maintain a master directory of all administrative procedures. Each procedure shall be categorized as public or confidential, and each procedure shall indicate which board policy authorizes its implementation. I was thinking about this, and if we're going to have an administrative procedure, they should be driven from a board policy. Now it's totally, and when that occurs, there should be a reference back to the policy. In the event that the administrative procedure is needed and is without the scope of a policy from the board, that's fine. There's no, not saying every administrative procedure has to be tied to a policy. I'm saying when it is tied to a policy, we should refer to it.
They could refer, Mr. Fredrickson?
What are we referring to when we're talking about procedures? I'm still a little.
I think what he's saying is when you come up with an administrative procedure, you refer back to a board policy. And in the absence of one, you could refer to this policy as authorizing the administration to create procedures in the most general sense. It's like when we have our policies, we refer back to statute. We refer back to what authority we have sometimes to take that action and make a policy. So I guess it's sort of a finger that points back so you can identify and legitimize the liberties taken.
So I guess I understand what I understand the statement he's making, that if you've developed a procedure, what policy is the procedure supporting? I get all that, but I don't understand what procedures we're talking about. I mean, are we talking, when you're talking administrative procedures, first of all, I mean, I was reading through it, and even if, I mean, I have no idea what the decision on this is going to be, but with the amount of procedures that's gone and the amount of work that's going to be required to go through those procedures, I don't see, and then post them up on the website, right? Isn't that what's being asked?
Little by little, I guess, as they come. I look
at it. Just can't be, I guess my point is, I'm looking at that. Look, I understand there's certain procedures that I think would be helpful that we may not have up there, certain things that the public may want. I'll give you an example, adult ed. You know, I was looking up there, couldn't find out how a kid gets referred. Yeah, it should be, it doesn't have to be a procedure either. It could be, you know, we're going to put it in the course of study. So I don't know. Mm-hmm. I guess that's why I'm getting a little confused. So you have footsteps. Is that considered a procedure?
I would think so, but it's already published on the website, so it doesn't have an additional requirement.
Right. So, I mean, I don't guess. I guess that's why, I mean, are we talking about procedures that, I don't know, HR, I'll go to them because they have a number of procedures. Are you talking about putting like HR procedures up? Or are you talking about, or are we talking about procedures that people need to, you know, I'm going to enroll my kid. What's that procedure to do that? Clarification? Well, I guess I'm still a little confused as to what we're talking about for procedures.
I would think most of them would go back to this policy, is authorizing the administration to create procedures. But sometimes there's esoteric things and there is a direct line and you can point out a policy that this triggered that. Just, I mean, in terms of if sometimes you have to go back and amend things that you amend in both places, sometimes having that continuity and alignment helps.
No, I get the tie-in. I get the statement.
But I don't think it's absolutely critical. If there is no specific policy, then you can use the generic or just leave it blank. We don't have a legal reference for every policy. Many do. Not all of them do.
Right.
But when there is a reference, it's better to include it than not to include it. Like if we're building something based on that citizenship test, it's better to put a pointer to that statute than to omit it. But if it doesn't exist, then you don't include it at all.
So I apologize. I don't think I was clear in my, I'm sorry, I mean.
Sure.
I don't think I was clear in my question. I'm going to go back. I understand why, if you're going to have this policy, you may want to refer back. If you wrote a procedure and you have reference to a policy, so you can reference back, because it helps. If the policy changes, it may affect the procedure and back and forth. Mm-hmm. So again, I was going back to, I don't understand what procedures are we talking about. Are we talking about, I guess I'm a little confused, what the range of procedures that we're talking about is. Because it's talking about having posted by April 30th, 2017. Are we talking about all procedures in the buildings? Are we talking about, I guess I'm a little confused, that's all. And I don't know what's considered a procedure and what's not, what's considered, good practice or not. So that's kind of where I was leading to.
Well, I would think that the date is flexible. I mean, I think that's a target date. We know that it's in our administrative procedures are not all updated and organized, and I think this is just an effort to push the envelope and to become more organized. Ms. Van Twyver?
Well, you're not going to be surprised, but I am not going to vote for this. I believe it's micromanaging. I don't believe putting a date on it is good for our administration. I do not see how this helps children learn, and we have many more important things to do with curriculum and other policies that I just see that this is wasting our time, and I will not vote for it here, and I will not vote for it at the board meeting.
Thank you. Mr. Kaufman.
Thank you. To try and answer the question, which policies, the administration has identified the policies. You know which policies have been created that through my 91A, through my right to know request, the administration has provided me with their procedures. Sorry, not policies. Their procedures. My word. Wrong word. And it is those procedures that administer process within the district that we're asking to be included, that I'm asking to be included via this policy change. Dr. Brown has already spoken to the point where most of these will be done by April. If you recall her last statement, the next time I speak with her, I'm going to ask her to be clear about what those dates are for each of the various directors. But largely, she has already committed to providing these things. And quite frankly, this isn't even a best practice for any organization. This is a standard practice. You identify your procedures, you document them, you somehow categorize them, and you provide a revision history. That's basic administration 101, as far as I'm concerned, based upon the training I've received as a professional project manager. So to ask the administration to document that which they've already got is a matter of good practice, standard practice. Best practice, I could embellish upon this to make it better, but I believe this is an absolute minimum that should be done. As to Ms. Van Twyver's comment that you think this is micromanaging, I just happen to disagree. I think what we have now is an absolute mess. For me, it is a worst practice. I am embarrassed for the administrators who have 10 and 15 years late producing a document that for their department that doesn't show it's, for me, it doesn't show they're being administered professionally. And I see it as my role here on the board and on this committee to ensure that there's accountability and transparency. We've talked about that before. These administrative procedures exist. Please don't interrupt.
I'm sorry.
These procedures exist. They've existed for a long time. The administration uses them on a daily basis to conduct the business of the district. From a transparency point of view, the people, if they reflect to staff or they reflect back to the public or parents or whatever, they should know what these policies are and they should have a way of finding them and being able to refer to them. And they should be maintained in a professional manner. That's all that this does. As far as a date, like I said, I think Dr. Brown has already begun to address that. And I think without a date, there again is no accountability. And I feel that it's really lacking in this area in the district. And I'm pretty persistent, I think you'll find.
Absolutely.
And so this is, I was talking to a friend about this, and he said, well, you could explain it this way. I don't know how many people remember that old Midas commercial. You know, it was probably the young people out there probably never saw it, but it was like these guys underneath the vehicle and he's looking at brakes or a muffler or whatever, and he goes, it's one of those pay me now or pay me later things. One of these days, we're gonna have to address this as a school district. Now is a good time to do it because we have an administration that's new, in some ways transitional, that it's a good time for us to recoup on bad practices and bring forward good practices. And I think that's what I'm trying to do here, is to recommend that these procedures be documented. And if that is micromanaging, I would argue it should have been done through the course of normal business, and it wouldn't have to be, in your words, micromanaged at this point if people were doing their jobs all along. And I'm sorry to say that, but that's what I believe. I believe people have been lacking in their responsibilities, and you can't go 10 years and not update a document that deals with finance or HR. I'm sorry, that's my opinion.
Mr. Kaufman, I've heard your rant for many, many times.
Excuse me, could we please keep it civil?
I'm keeping it civil.
I don't want to call each other ranting. I think that...
Well, it is a rant. It's been for three times we've heard this or more.
It's a discussion.
I have the floor. You made a comment that the administration procedures are in a mess. Can you give me an example of that?
I'll be happy to bring them to you. Absolutely.
I want to hear them right now. You speak in front of the public. You have accused our administration.
Well, actually, some of them were given to me. Most of them were given to me electronically. I do have my computer. Would you want to look at them?
No, I want you to tell me what they are. I want to hear you say what they are. I think
I'll be happy. We can defer this to the next meeting, and I'll bring the complete documentation so you can look at it. Would that be okay?
I think we don't need to defer it. I think we can act on it. We've had it three times. I was told by a teacher that she was fired over a procedure, administrative procedure, that she had never received. Now, if that's the case, I want to see those out there so it doesn't happen again. If it's just as simple as that, I want the transparency. And if I have a question for Mr. Kaufman, if we remove the date and just said all administrative procedures shall be posted on the district website without the date, knowing that the new administration is trying to catch up for the previous administration that fell down on this task, would that at least be a compromise that maybe you could go forward with? It presents the best practices or standard practice of posting without having a tripwire of a date where everything's overdue by.
Well, answer your question, I would consider that as an option. but I would appreciate it if Dr. Brown would provide us with an email that would just refresh some of the information she shared with us at the last meeting, which was some dates that she had already worked out with her staff as to when they would be updated. So I would like to just know that at least the administration has a calendar that it's working towards. In that regard, I'd be happy to do
I know that. There have been several dates. Sometimes they were June 30th or July 1st. Yep. I just don't want to tangle over a date when we're trying to get to a goal. Mr. Fredrickson?
I would recommend, next policy meeting is only 2 weeks away, correct?
Certainly.
It's not going to hurt anything pushing it out. Mr. Kaufman could bring in the data that Ms. Van Twyver, you know, asked. The other thing is, you know, with that follow-up, we get some clarifications to where we are in terms of a date. I mean, putting a date down and calling it a goal and you're writing it in policy is not the way to go. So if you're gonna put something down, it should be something we can meet. And I guess I'm a little confused, and I apologize because I keep hearing terms like policy and procedure as we're talking. And, you know, when talking about all the policies have to be posted. So all the policies, as far as I know, are posted. Mm-hmm. I think what you're talking about is procedural things. And I have no issue with putting up and making sure they're updated because obviously that's appropriate. You know, when you're talking about the public that has to go to the website and use those procedures, when the public has to use those procedures, you know, to enroll their child or sign up for something, I mean, that makes a lot of sense. But if we're talking about procedures, finance, HR, I mean, and you're talking about putting them on the website, I start getting a little confused as to what you're talking about. I mean, and if you want to talk about having them updated or reviewed, that may be a conversation we also want to have with Dr. Brown. Also, because I mean, what's a reasonable date to go ahead and do that? I will tell you this: the people down at, if you're talking HR, you're talking finance, I'm not sure where they're going to find the time, and you're going to have to, you know, some things are going to have to go by the wayside. This is probably not an appropriate time of year if we are talking about doing it. That's the reason why I think you may want to relook at the date, or you may want to relook at what we're doing. On that, it's not a very good time of year to be pulling people out from. You know, you're talking about going into the budget season, you know, you're talking about a lot of things that are going on, and these people are very busy at this time. So mm-hmm. I would recommend at least contact, you know, I can go back to Dr. Brown and find out what's being asked, find out what's a reasonable date, what's, you know, what type of procedure we're talking about.
Thank you. What I was suggesting was we get rid of the date, because as Mr. Fredrickson said, and I concur, putting a date there in a policy is really not ideal. We could get the policy through without a date and review from time to time what, you know, what is the status, how well are we doing. I think that would accomplish the same, you know, goal without putting too much pressure, as you say. I don't think there is a good time of year, but certainly not, I mean, over the summer is a good time of year. There's no stress, but then there's no people here. So, you know, whatever. I think if we removed that deadline and just said all administrative procedures shall be posted on the district website and left it as a period, I think that would give a lot more discretion to the superintendent to complete the task or complete it by 50%, 60%, or whatever timeline she can reasonably do without interfering with her other tasks. Mr. Fredrickson?
So again, I would recommend that you hold off on a little bit so I can come back with an intelligent statement and say, hey, if we want to do this, it might take us 2 years to get it done, or if you want to do it in a sooner time, we'll need to get some more help to do it. I don't know. I just think that, you know, I'm a little concerned. I mean, I have no problem with transparency. I'm pretty much an open book. I always have been, so I have no issues with people looking at it. I just think of where we are now and what you may be asking. I'm not sure what the scope is, so that's why I'm saying it may be worthwhile.
I think I agree with a lot of things you've said in terms of there's some procedures that are confidential. They just be up there by title. There are some that should be transparent, and those are public. Whether this takes 3 months or 3 years, I think you take one step at a time and you move towards the goal. So I would rather leave it open-ended and work with the administration to accomplish this. Mr. Kaufman.
I'll follow your lead on this in terms of removing the date. Mr. Fredrickson, I think if you, the HR department has 66 different procedures that I received. Each of them is in a single file. Each of them is structured like what I suggest in here, which has a, you know, a title header section, if you would, and it talks about who created it, when it was created, and, you know, and they actually have a numbering sequence, if I remember correctly, so, and a revision history. So that is largely in the format that I'm asking about. I think you'll find the areas where I think we need the most help and where I'm the most obsolete, there may be a 10 or 12 page document. There's really not that much material, except for the HR side, and I would grant that that is a big chunk of work. But the other ones as a 10 page document, I don't think that's an overwhelming responsibility for someone who lives and breathes that stuff on a daily basis to review a document in a day or two. I quite think, knowing that this discussion started in June, the fact that the district still can't produce a list is shocking to me. And that's what part of this policy is driven by, is that we should have a list of our policies. And if we flag them as public or confidential, that's fine. But those that are public would be made available. The important thing is here to document the policies that we have one, even if it's confidential, where the text wouldn't be available. But the fact is, we know we have a procedure. There is, I should say it another way, there is an administrative procedure that governs this area, and it's accounted for. And it's the accounting, it's the list, and it's the text of those things that I'm trying to accomplish here.
Ms. Van Twever?
I pass.
Okay. Do we have a motion? Oh, Mr. Fredrickson?
On page 2, it says confidential procedures shall be included in the master directory and is identified as confidential with the link to the associated procedure.
Without
a link.
Without a link, I'm sorry. Confidential procedures shall be presented to the Board of Education when created or modified. So we're not, I'm a little confused by that, only because, so you're talking, you're going to have a confidential procedure. We don't want to make it public.
Right.
So we're going to bring it to the board?
Discuss it in public.
Or we can go into non-public. Perhaps they present it, could be just in a confidential envelope, just for our review, and unless there's any problem, just to make us aware of, if 10 procedures were changed of a confidential nature, we would get a batch of 10 and say these are updated, because there would be nowhere else to go to see that information. That would be the only means of communicating it to the board.
So, I realize I'm fairly new. So we'd have a board meeting, and we would pass an envelope to the board members, go to non-public?
It could go in their packet, and you could send them out, and then at the next full board meeting, if there's any issues with it, we could go into non-public. If there's no issue, which is more than likely 99% of the time, that would just be fine. They would be notified. They presented to the board. Mr. Fredrickson.
I'm not, have you bounced this off Attorney Bolton by any chance?
No, but you have to keep in mind that administrative procedures are supposed to comport with the policies, and we're supposed to oversee the process. We can't oversee anything if it takes a right to know request to get a procedure, and we don't even know which ones to ask for because we don't even have a directory. That was the conundrum that we were in as board members. We couldn't get any information, and we're trying never to have this problem hit another board member again. Mr. Fredrickson.
I understand there was some angst over getting the procedures, where this all came from. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the actual process of notifying the board of confidential procedures without making it public. I mean, I just don't understand. I mean, is that okay? I mean, that's been gone through by...
There's a lot of confidential things that we do that we don't notify the public. Most of our negotiations are confidential, and we have those in yellow packets with confidential on the envelope, and a lot of times nothing gets discussed. It's just this is an update. We got one for the, I guess, the brief that went to the Supreme Court on the custodial thing. That was one of the recent ones. Mrs. Seem.
I think you're talking across. I think Mr. Fredrickson is alluding to is that sometimes it is confidential to the point where you wouldn't put it in writing and let board members look at it because if it's personnel related, only I know I think I had a similar conversation with Dr. Brown. So I think his suggestion that it go, that Steve look at it, because I think that's what he's alluding to. Did I lose you with that?
No, I would think if it goes in somebody's personnel file and we're not supposed to know about it, that's fine. That's confidential and the board doesn't know about it. But there's no procedure. There's only a procedure if you're saying generically all teachers in this conundrum will be treated in thus and thus fashion. Then it becomes a procedure. At that point, there's no harm in sharing it with the board. I guess you don't write procedures, administrative procedures, that are too personal to any employee or...
I think, again, though, he is going to particular confidential procedures, which would be confidential to the point where board members might not know. And I think what you're saying is just the process that occurs. For instance, Dr. Brown, last meeting, went through with me, actually it was public, how she had done some training with the staff members to tell them how if someone was being mentored, if someone was being mentored is the right word. If someone was being mentored, then that wouldn't be. The process of the steps you take, like, if you're mentoring someone, the first thing is you call them in and you sit down and you clearly define what the issues are and you come up with a suggested program of correction. And then you come back the next time and you review the progress or lack of progress that's been made on that process. I think that's what she's talking about, and I think you're concerned about getting into particulars. Am I wrong, Mr. Fredrickson?
I just want to make sure that we're being we're not raising any issues, and to contact Attorney Bolton about that one paragraph, make sure that it's not raising any issues. You're talking, you could probably answer that in a quick email back, and then we could raise this, in addition to with removing the date on there. We could just we're going to be back in 2 weeks anyway. Put it right at the top of the agenda.
Okay, I think if it's something that was that confidential, you wouldn't write it down in a procedure. I can't conceive of anything that would be so confidential that you didn't want, if you don't want the board to know it, don't write down a procedure. If it's in a written procedure, I don't see the harm of the board knowing, but if you want to run this sentence by Attorney Bolton, I have no problem with that. Would you like to send it to him?
Yeah, I could do that. That's no problem.
Okay, that's fine.
Do you feel comfortable with that? Is that right?
Oh, I do. I do, okay. And I'd be happy that you're comfortable with it, too.
Yep. So am I wrong in saying that the issue becomes, let's just speak theoretically. If someone is being mentored because their services have been found lacking, It is the particular individual and their circumstances that cannot be shared with the board.
That's correct.
And that's what I'm saying. I'm saying and that is the question for Mr. Bolton. Is that where you're going? And I can see the need for that because as I sit here, there are so many different levels. I mean, you have 2,000 employees. So are we going to be called in to any mentoring that happens for this, 2,000 employees, because that would be an awful lot of, I have no idea. I do agree with Doris and Howard to the extent that I have no idea what volume that would be because we were never included in those dialogues, but I can see the question that you're asking, and I think it's probably a good one.
Mr. Kaufman?
In the event there is an employment action, which I think is the context that Mrs. Zeme is speaking. Those rules are already quite public, right? They're part of the grievance procedure for teachers and for union employees. So the procedure is documented in this particular case via the union contracts. They have provision, they have the language where those are the governing rules of an employment-related thing. These procedures that I think we're addressing are, they might, some of them obviously impact people because HR has 66 of them, but I don't think any of those are, and we can certainly look at them. I'm all in favor of, I'll bring the information that I received. I only have electronically the HR ones.
Yeah, that'd be good.
But I can bring in the other documents that were sent to me. And so, Ms. Hawensey, I think getting feedback from Mr. Bolton and bringing this forth to the next meeting where we can look at the actual material, I think other people would perhaps become a little bit more sympathetic to what my frustration was, and I think that's a great idea.
Okay, and that's fine. And to me, I think the solution is, if it's that confidential, don't write the policy. But we'll see what the attorney, and I'm open to that. The next...
Excuse me, one thing?
Yeah.
Would Mr. Fredrickson, before you send that to Mr. Bolton, is it okay if Ms. O'Hensey updates it, because we made a couple of changes tonight, a few wordsmithing, and let her send you that to send to him?
Okay.
So that way we'd be working from the latest changes.
There's only two. To remove the may to shall on the middle of the first page, and to get rid of the date.
Right.
And those, and I think you've got those. Okay, so then I think.
So are you gonna just update and send me a copy, or do you want me to send the one that I have?
You can send the one you have and just make note of those two changes. Unless you want another copy, it's whichever. They're minor.
Oh, I had shall, and then we're just eliminating that sentence.
Yes,
and good.
Yeah, okay. And I don't think they bear
on... Just the date and put a period there.
Right, and they don't bear on the confidential procedures sentence that you're talking about anyway. Yep.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, great. The next policy is GCO, dismissal, non-renomination, removal of teachers. This one was redlined, so we're keeping only one edition. The new edition will be... Section B, a previous non-renominated nation of a teacher or employee shall not be grounds for permanently excluding such individual from consideration when applying for another position in the district. I believe that one section we had consensus on. The other sections, there was a lot of dispute. Ms. Van Twyver.
POPS 8216.1 is the exact same thing as A here. That's
excuse me?
POPS 8216.1.
Yes, that's the old name.
That's right. And it's the same thing as what you have red with all the red lines gone. And number two, don't we already have a GCO and a GCOA?
We have an A and a B. I don't think we have GCO.
Well, I thought evaluation of professional staff was GCO, and GCOA was evaluation of athletic coach.
Right, and B was extracurricular advisors. Do you have a better name for it?
No, I don't, but I don't think it can be GCO.
Okay, I wasn't aware that there was another GCO.
Well, I would ask that you check that out before we... And so there's the only thing would be to change the title on the alphabetic
correct
moniker on here and rescind POPS 8216.1.
Right. So we can leave that to Tara to make sure that that isn't already in use, and if it is, to come up with another letter name in the same G category. Is there any other discussion, Mr. Fredrickson?
Just for clarification,
then you're
next.
Go ahead. I saw you first.
Just so you're saying you're going to just, the only one that you're going to add on there is B, correct?
Right.
Okay, I'm just going to give you my opinion on it. And it, you know, certainly People can disagree by any means, but putting B on there is unnecessary. It's you know, the higher the past practice, the superintendent's already given you her, you know, her spin on that, that we would reconsider, you know, under certain circumstances, people that may have been non-renominated. You know, you might have had somebody that was a bad fit at one grade, could go to another grade, mm-hmm. What have you. So I'm not, I'm just making a statement here. I don't need clarification, but I'm not really sure why that's needed on that policy. Because it's a practice. It's not a policy. I mean, it's not going to change if you have a principal that's not going to, or an administrator that's not going to reconsider that. I mean, they could say they're going to do it. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's more of
right,
a practice.
Right. It's just guidance, and I think it was given to me by other board members because the previous administration, they were concerned that it was an unwritten practice. So this is putting it out in the open and encouraging them that we don't want them to narrow down the pool of applicants based on previous, non-renominations. Mr. Kaufman?
Thank you. I was going to point out that it's just A and B that would remain, which is what Mr. Fredrickson did. Excuse me. But I would say, whoever is editing this document, you have lots of extra spaces in the B paragraph. So
okay.
There's double spaces, just
I'm sure Tara will. Tara didn't put this on the form. She said let it go through committee, and then she would update the formatting after it came through. Ms. Van Twyver?
Could you refresh my memory? Is this the first time we have seen this?
No.
This?
Second or third, if not. I think it's the third time we've seen this. We have a motion.
So, motion to approve 8216.1 with a new name, as amended, as presented, actually.
As redlined.
Yes, as redlined.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Okay. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed, say nay.
Okay. Aye.
Okay. The next policy is ILBAS. I had two conversations with Dr. Scott Manti of the Department of Education. I was not aware of the fact that this statute, 193C:10, that allowed parents to review and inspect their child's assessment questions and answers was actually in effect. When I had asked the department previously, I never got a positive answer. When I spoke to Dr. Manti this past month, he said, yes, they do it. And he talked about five or six incidents that he was aware of, that the parent tells the principal that it goes up to the department. They send down a sealed package, which is opened in front of the parent. They review the assessment and the answers, and it gets sent back or destroyed. I don't know which, but it stays in the office of the principal who's showing it to the parent for to review. My second conversation with him was I asked if school principals and board members would be allowed to inspect and review the assessment questions and correct answers, not student answers. And he saw absolutely no problem with this. I thought principals, being the head leaders of a school, they might want to be aware of you know, what's in the assessments moving year to year. So I thought that would be instructive for them. So I wanted to make sure they were aware that they would be able to do this. I think this is a case where people didn't know that they were able to do this and they didn't exercise this ability or this right. This is a model policy that it was taken from Milford School District, which I imagine came through New Hampshire School Boards Association. I'm not positive on that, but
It says the Nashua Board of Education on here.
Yeah, so it, the approval date on the bottom. Oh, that's there's no approval date.
On mine there is.
I know, but there is no. We never approved it, so it's a new policy.
So how does it get, that date get on there? It says 5/31/2016. Am I looking at the right one? ILBAS.
ILBAS, but we never, is this, is my understanding this is new. Mr. Coffey?
May I suggest that when it was copied over from its source, that was the original date that they used.
It may be the Milford date.
So that's
date.
How it got carried over here, but right. It's not as a result of a board action here, because as right. you
has
say, we
have. Has the National Board of Education on there? How
I
that
put that on. This is not formatted by Tara.
Well,
and Tara told me that she wasn't going to put them in the format until they went through the committee.
Well, I think that's misrepresentation of what you're presenting to us.
It is. I'm telling you, it's a totally new policy.
So I'm going to strike the National Board of Education off the top, and I'm going to scratch the date below.
Thank you. Mr. Fredrickson?
Are you sure that wasn't an approved policy?
It was approved by Milford School District.
Have you?
That's where I got it off of. There was some contention in Alton, and I was searching the web in helping somebody in Alton. I stumbled over this. After stumbling over it, I had contact with Dr. Manti, and I spoke to him at length twice. So that's.
I'm not debating on
right.
the, you know, the law and
that's
everything else.
And
I did.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I did check to verify there was a way to go ahead and have parents look at the assessment and that. The last sentence I'm not sure about, so I'm going to have to take your word. But what I'm saying is I believe on the website, okay, there is an ILBAS, and it includes everything except for the accessibility
okay.
of assessment material. So you may want to, what I think you may want to double check on that, because I didn't do this, but I think really what you're looking to do.
Yes, yes.
Speaking of Ms.
I think I did just add that one paragraph, so the formatting
so
should have been read.
So what Ms. Mantuiva said was 100% correct, that this was an existing policy, and
right.
what you're looking to do is you're looking to modify an existing
correct.
Policy. So.
So it's only those last two paragraphs in the title that we're asking to add, and the a board date is the correct board date, and it is a board policy, because I didn't put the top stuff in there. I just pulled this. Yes,
I'm confused. You're saying that this is ILBAS is an existing policy
if we had
on our database, and that you took that and retitled it and put the date on it.
I believe I took it from Milford, and I believe.
Well, not only that, usually when we have a policy that has changes in it, they're done in red so that we understand what
yeah.
has been changed. And there's nothing in here that indicates that you have added anything to this policy. I think you really have misrepresented what's here.
I didn't intentionally do it, but if you read the top, it says, the National School District shall count all communications, whether by letter, email, or phone call from a parent. That's something that we did in the spring since I've been on the board. So reviewing that, that's something that we just passed.
But this doesn't even have our regular header on it.
It does not. You're correct, because Tara didn't put it in the formatting that you'd so desire. This was just a copy and paste that I gave her to be convenient for her so that she wouldn't have to type everything up anew. She told me that she would just put it in the packet and she wasn't going to reformat it. I assumed that she would. She did not.
Well, I'm going to talk to her about that, because the policy, that's one of the ways we know that it is one of our policies, is that it has that header
right.
on it.
My addition was the paragraph accessibility of assessment and materials. Because that was the new feature, Mr. Fredrickson.
In all fairness to Ms. Kinsella, she wouldn't have known that this was an existing document unless if she went back or somebody told her to do that. So when she receives it in this format,
right.
which she received, and I'm not trying to, you know, maybe if you want, you can blame me for not double checking and going down with it, but she's not going to know when she receives, because she receives a lot of documents that way,
mm-hmm.
that's typed up or done on your word processor that comes in. So, you know, if there's an error that was made here, it certainly wasn't Ms. Kinsella. You know, maybe it was mine. I apologize.
No, I believe I sent it to her in red originally. I mean, I could verify that. But in any case, that seems to be what the case is and what we've got in front of us. So we've got an existing policy with two new paragraphs at the end, adding the text that I was instructed by Dr. Manti that was acceptable to him and that would allow our parents the ability to review those tests, which previous to this, I think a lot of people believed, and we were told that these were confidential, copyrighted information, that we couldn't see them, that they only released one or two questions a year, and many parents in this district and other districts didn't believe that they had access to these tests. And with the test scores coming out, and the department put out a press release just today saying the scores were up from last year, parents may want to see what their child did. So in that sense, it's timely that when they get the results, that they can follow up and actually look at the results of what their child did. Is there any other discussion? Mr. Fredrickson.
I do have one recommendation if you're going to put this through as a policy. When it says a parent or legal guardian shall direct a request for inspection or view to the pupil school, I apologize, in a letter or email, you're going to want to add in a letter or email because that goes along with the state procedure that they do. So they request, it's pretty specific when I looked up the state procedures. It says a parent will make a request in a letter or email to the
state. So you want to add under request.
Yeah, and the reason that was given for that was they want to be able to log in an official, rather than just a phone call, you need to log it in as an official thing.
Okay, so you want to eliminate the phone call, like above it says letter, email, or phone call. So down below you want a letter or an email.
Yeah, I'm just telling you what's on the particular procedure so at the state. So
it would be simpler for the administration to have that written down too. Mr. Kaufman.
I have a file that has all the policies in it. It may not be the most current, but we do not have an ILBAS currently in the district, at least with the limited. We have an ILBAA, but we do not have an ILBAS.
I believe this, the top of this we wrote, and I know I initiated it, and we did pass it earlier this year.
Okay.
Because that was, previously, we had a letter that was sent out, and we had no policy. So every year, we'd have to send out a letter. This way, making it a policy made it more permanent.
How up to date is your database?
Since the beginning of the year.
He took them.
That was the file that you gave me, actually.
Okay. That was prior to this passage on May 31st.
Motion to approve ILBAS as amended.
And the amendment would be in a letter or an email?
Letter or email. And obviously to correct the date if it gets approved.
Update it would be adding.
Date, sorry.
Okay.
I object to doing this. I want to see the exact policy that comes off of our database with changes in red.
We like working from marked up copies. I kind of agree with you, Elizabeth.
Well, thank you.
Well,
that's
it makes perfect sense.
That's the procedure. We've always followed that. I'm voting against if someone seconds it.
I'm sorry?
That I'm going to vote against it if someone seconds
it. I'll withdraw it.
Then we'll just put it to the top of the meeting next time in a red line copy. And where are we on our list? ILD, non-academic surveys, questionnaires. Non-academic surveys, questions, and surveys, effective August 25th, 2015. This was a another state law that went through, and we need a policy to, again, tell parents that they have this ability when it comes to non-educational or non-academic. They use both terms when the questionnaires come to students. The parents will be notified at least 10 days prior to the district administering this non-academic or non-educational survey to students. Parents may opt out their child from a survey or questionnaire, and must opt out either by notifying the district in writing or electronically. Parents and guardians who do not opt out their children will be deemed to have consented to the survey or questionnaire or other documents and assignments. Mr. Kaufman.
When I was substitute teaching, I would see these things come through every once in a while. And I always felt then, and I feel now, I think the parents should be notified that a survey is coming, and that they should have the option of opting in. I don't think it should be a default situation if the parent does not respond that they give implicit approval to participate in these surveys. The default is no, and if the parent wants the child to participate in the survey, they opt in. Because I remember some of the things that went home, and I couldn't believe what it was, and I think the default should be opt out, and if a parent wants to participate, they can send in the approval in written form. So I have a problem with the next to last paragraph. I think it should be, you know, I'm sorry I haven't done that, but I would rather see us, the parents can opt in if they want to participate.
Mr. Fredrickson?
Two things. One, number one, in terms of opting out or opting in, I think if we're putting it up on the website and we're sending out notification, the parents will have enough notification to know whether or not to exclude, you know, whether or not they don't want their kid to participate. My concern with doing a reverse in it as an opt-in is you're going to be looking at some surveys like the teen risk survey. You're going to end up with low enrollment on that. So you're going to, as the kids get a little bit older, it's difficult to get permission slips back and forth on things like surveys. So I would encourage you to leave it the way the law currently states, which has an opt out, or at least I would go out and search out for more information. I did show this to the guidance counselors today. I met with all three levels of the guidance counselors on a scheduled meeting. I did show them this particular policy. Did not have an issue with it. Might change a little bit of practice, but two years ago when we did do that survey, the teen risk at risk survey, at least at the middle school, they followed this procedure. They had it up. They did plenty of notification out there. The middle school guidance director indicated she got nothing but positive responses back. So again, just a couple that. So I would encourage to leave it as is, as the way the law states. And then the other thing I would say, I'm a little confused on paragraph 1, 2, 3. It says the surveys, questionnaires, or other documents such as classroom assignment. I'm not sure why that's there. You may want to remove that because I don't understand. Or if you give me some clarification as to what you're referring to, I might be able to give you a clearer statement to put up.
Well, I have that in. It says here from the state law, surveys, questionnaires, or other documents. My concern was I've had parents tell me sometimes assignments are equivalent to surveys, and this is not within the districts that I'm thinking of specifically, but sometimes they get surveys. The one I was thinking of was, it was on religion, on politics, where the student had to self-identify what he believes in, whether he had a religion or not. If he did not, he had to follow certain other protocols. And I think it's like sexual orientation. Sometimes these assignments, if they're too specific and they ask a student to disclose this information as part of an assignment, it's equivalent to a surveying what his beliefs are. And I think That's what I was trying to, you know, I don't believe most of our teachers do that, but if they're going to make a survey out of a classroom assignment, it's equivalent. It doesn't have to come from UNH and be labeled a survey or a questionnaire. If a teacher decides to implement a survey or a questionnaire within the confines of her classroom, even just for the sake of her classroom, it's still equivalent in terms of putting the student on a spot and having to, you know, self-disclose, like his sexual orientation, what is his beliefs on this, this, and this. Sometimes children are struggling to identify who and what they are. They don't need to have these revealing surveys even in a classroom, is what I'm trying to say. If you think that we can add some clarity to that, but the statute itself says surveys, questionnaires, or other documents. What are the other documents? The only thing that came to mind was such as a classroom assignment, like a homework assignment. This is where the parent found it and brought it to my attention. Mr. Fredrickson?
Well, and this is where I'd be a little careful on doing that. So if what you're saying, and I'm just trying to, you know, mm-hmm. expand upon this, when you talk about a classroom assignment, we just got done with a number of social studies teachers here. Right. I suspect as part of their routine class assignments, they're going to ask kids, you know, what their beliefs are. You know, when you're talking about politics, it's going to be part of the classroom, you know, engaging with the kids. So are we saying now, as part of a social studies class, we want them to go get permission posted 10 days ahead of time on the assignment and stuff? That's why I'm saying I'd be a little bit careful. I think I understand what your concern is, that a teacher's going to run as part of an assignment, they're going to run a survey in the class about, you would say.
Well, I think it's easier for a student to say, you know, there's this political thought and that political thought, and compare and contrast. Same with religions. And if he wants to do, say, that this might have a stronger argument or that, but I just think that forcing a kid to self-disclose, self-identify, might be a bit much. So I don't know how to word that, but those are the concerns that constituents and others outside the district have brought to me, and that was what are or other documents. I think if teachers understood the intent of this, they wouldn't lock down their assignments to corner a student in such a way as to make them feel uncomfortable in that sense. Mr. Kaufman.
Thanks. When, like I said, I use the example of when I was substitute teaching. Most of the survey type things that I saw were not generated by our teachers for their students, but they were from an external source, such as the University of New Hampshire. So somebody somewhere in the University of New Hampshire system needs to do a survey of students so they somehow get approval to come to our students. So I see a distinction between the coursework that our teachers are working with. For me, my objection to these kinds of things is I'm more concerned about external surveys that come mm-hmm. from an outside source rather than what our teachers are doing. So I don't know if it helps to make a distinction in that regard.
I think what you're doing is reinforcing what I said.
Okay.
Okay. So which is
because the survey is coming from the external sources. I get that. You know, we want to, or you know, something that's going to deal with, you know, risk survey or anything. I get it. We should let the parents know. It's probably not appropriate that a kid goes home and says, "Hey, I just, you know, they're asking me all these questions about my family's lifestyle, what was going on." And the parent didn't have an opportunity to at least know what was going on. I'm not arguing that, and that's in the state statute. What I'm saying is I would stay away from, it's going to create a lot of confusion if you start talking about such as a classroom assignment. And, you know, if there's something that does come up that maybe, you know, I say as a school, maybe popped up that we should have offered, that should be addressed as a one-on-one condition. I'm a little concerned if you put that in there, people are going to start challenging some of your assignments that are going on, and I keep going back to the social studies only because I saw the politics up there. Okay. I would think that'd be so I would recommend if you're looking at, you know, making this a policy, which
to strike that line, that
just
clause?
Strike out okay. such as classroom assignment.
Okay.
Do we want to make a particular provision that perhaps all external surveys need to go through this process? Or do you think that would be the default action anyway?
You're all set. You got that. You got it covered with you right here, okay? As long as it's a non-academic. I mean, anything non-academic, that's what it's very specific
okay.
on.
Okay, great. Yeah. Thank you.
Any other comments? A motion?
Motion to accept ILD non-educational questionnaire surveys and research as amended. And the only amendment is to strike in the third paragraph the phrase, such as a classroom assignment. Everything else is as presented.
Is there a second? I'll second it. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, nay.
Nay.
Okay. And that ends our
move to adjourn
list.
Okay. Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
We will close at 7:52.